This is the story of how we rediscovered our love affair with high-speed rail travel and how an unpopular nationalised industry created the ever-popular 125 train. In the 1970s, British Rail was the butt of jokes for the nation's comedians.
British Rail intend to maintain their standards. But now for the good news.
During a period of industrial gloom and political upheaval, how did the unexpected triumph of the Intercity 125 help save British Rail and give us the age of the train?
A bit of fresh air and fun is easy because
this is the age
of the train.
Mr. Peter Parker.
In 1976, Peter Parker became the new boss of British Rail. He was a high-profile businessman, but he was facing his toughest job yet, trying to turn around an industry that was near rock bottom.
Pray silence for Mr. Peter Parker, a member of the Royal Victorian Order and chairman of British Railways Board, a distinguished guest of honour.
For us is short time. 5 years is longer than most governments dare to think.
It's not fashionable to be the kind of man who is a captain of industry, a socialist, a man about the theatre who had been an actor, an authority on Blake, a man who spoke Japanese. I mean, he was a really extraordinary man.
I wouldn't mind having a look inside, actually.
Filling it all up.
British Rail had suffered 30 years of decline, and Parker was assessing the business from top to bottom.
I often think that, you know, industrial democracy has got a lot to do with the standards in the lavatory as well as appearances in the boardroom. Worth every penny!
From Birmingham to Bristol, Liverpool or Leeds, buy a ticket, take a train and travel where you please. To Manchester or Glasgow, Canterbury...
Parker was in charge of a rail system struggling to promote itself to customers in a new age of travel. The message wasn't always getting through.
So take a seat on the midday train and be in time for the start of the game.
Good morning.
Good evening. When they came to me and asked me to say some kind words about British Rail, frankly, I told BR to be off. Then they offered me £1,000. I said, I'm not a man who can be bought. Then they offered me £2,000. Good evening.
Everyone loved their cars, me too. And the train, alas, seemed to be fading. Beeching had just axed everything. And it was really the pit for the poor old train.
Parker had more than the railways to worry about. The new chairman was in charge of 55 ships, 29 hotels, and more than 200 restaurants and cafes.
Derek, the bags are here.
He was at the head of 250,000 employees. For years, British Rail had complained about inadequate government investment, but to its critics, it was overstaffed, out of date, and a waste of public money.
Now, you do your bit, and we'll do our bit, and we'll try to lose £100 million of your money every year.
For Parker, there wasn't much to smile about. He had to modernise at a time of cutbacks. Too many trains were late, and too many looked old-fashioned.
It's a bit of an early stage, really, to say what I can see ahead. My feeling of it is that I've got a view of the Himalayas. I've just got to that point where the peaks stand out very clearly. I haven't scaled any yet, but I can see, I think, more and more what the problems are.
There was just too much short-termism. That, I mean, his message all along and his understanding was that railways were very long-term. When you invest something in a railway, when you build a new train like the high-speed train, you're looking at something that's got a life of 35, 40 years, maybe longer, with refurbishment. But politicians were never looking further than 5 years ahead.
Peter Parker knew he had to change the way we thought about the railways. He'd have to take on the doubters, and that included the unions.
I'm pleased.
Parker had to reduce the complaints, get more customers, make more money, and keep his workers happy. It wasn't going to be easy.
British Rail in the late 70s, early 80s was really set up not much different from Victorian lines. So it's very, very difficult for the railways, in an almost impossible position. It was a perfect storm of things going against them.
The man that is responsible for the tragedy of this railway,
if he comes and starts charming, or endeavouring to charm us out of the trees, then I'm afraid that would be the wrong way to do industrial relations on British Railways Board.
It wasn't particularly well run, I think, at that point, from the consumer's point of view. Engineering-wise, I mean, it was a very safe railway, but the consumer did tend to kind of get left out of it a bit.
We had the most appalling unions at the time, and they just objected to everything.
We're down-to-earth people. We see things as they are, and we want to give a service to the public of this country, and I don't think we want to be charmed into doing it.
Do stop complaining. Don't pull the...
Sometimes the criticism went beyond a joke.
And simply do what you're told whenever you see this sign. There we are.
I think British Rail will always be a butt. It's like mother-in-laws. It doesn't matter if it does well or does badly. It's either the trains are too full and you can't get a seat and therefore it's rubbish, or they're too, stone empty and, why can't they run a proper business?
Never once have I understood a railway announcer. For instance...
The train now standing in platform 4 is a 4:45 and 4 is on
time. I think... People have a dual attitude to the railways. It's always bloody railways, bloody British Rail. Commuters, for instance, don't really want to go to work on the train each day. It's a distress purchase. If you provide a perfect journey for a commuter, he doesn't notice it. He takes it for granted. And if you have a slight delay, that gets it. So railways are always struggling with their image.
But amid the doom and gloom, Peter Parker had worked out a new strategy. He was going to revive Britain's love affair with high-speed trains and find new ways to reach beyond the Channel into Europe. Parker knew there'd always been a special kind of glamour about high-speed trains. The express trains of the 1930s set speed records and created new standards for luxury travel.
The steam trains were romance, just wonderful, very, very fast as anything that moves today in this country. And they were beautiful things to look at.
Long before Peter Parker arrived at British Rail, it was obvious Britain needed a new high-speed train. In 1968, Barbara Castle, the Transport Minister, visited British Rail's engineering works in Derby to give the scheme her public backing.
Railwaymen were all trying to go faster. What they did was you bought a fast locomotive and train, and then you tweaked the infrastructure, you ease the curves, you move track across so they didn't have to slow for curves and so on, you ease junctions, and you went faster, but eventually you got to the point where you was going as fast as you could with the trains you got, and then you moved up another step.
An ambitious new project was launched, the Advanced Passenger Train, a tilting train which could travel on old-fashioned curving rail tracks at 150 miles an hour.
Now, into this came British Rail Research, which was a new organisation set up, and it took on a lot of engineers from outside the industry. Not all from the aircraft industry, that's a myth, but a lot of engineers, and they came in and looked at existing railway engineering and thought, old-fashioned, boring.
Making their way across Europe, three pretty girls decorate our scene. A whole new world of travel.
According to British Rail's publicity films, the 1970s were going to be a sophisticated, cosmopolitan era on the railways across Europe. A new generation of high-speed trains was being built. At last, some of the lost glamour of the 30s might come back.
Today, the scene in a high-speed train is changed out of recognition. Staring out of the corridor window is no longer the high spot of a journey. For whatever your mood, all the right things are around to rest or exhilarate you.
In other countries, money was being poured into electrification and fast new expresses. But in Britain, budgets were tighter.
What was really irritating about being on the board of British Rail is that the people would constantly tell you how wonderful the bullet train was, with no telling you about how much it cost, how much it was subsidized, how the government was so behind it, how it had taken years and years and years to develop, and how they constantly improved it.
While British Rail was pursuing its own prestige project, the APT tilting train, behind the scenes a cheaper, less romantic idea was brewing, a high-speed diesel train which could travel at 125 miles an hour. The high-speed train team was headed by Terry Miller, a lifelong railway engineer.
Terry Miller went to the British Railways board and said, would you like a 125 mile an hour train and you deliver your prototype in 22 months?
The race was on between two teams, both working within British Rail. There was fierce rivalry between the APT tilting train project, based at BR Research, and Miller's engineering team.
The conventional engineers, who were extremely upset, not to say furious, about all this, what we now call dissing, from the advanced passenger train people at BR Research, said, well, we can go fast as well. So, yeah, the rivalry was huge, and they came back from one meeting, and the engineering director said, you know, they say they can do 150, we'll show them. It was creative tension.
The tilting train could run at 150 miles an hour, but it was still being tested. Suddenly, its rival, the more conventional high-speed train, was going to be more than a stopgap.
Hey, lady, forget all that. Meet the swinging, mixing, mincing, slicing, shredding Kenwood chef. Woo!
In the early 1970s, one of Britain's leading designers was called in. Kenneth Grange was at the cutting edge of industrial design. He supplied the look for products which became household names. By now, the conventional high-speed train was almost ready, 5 years ahead of its rival, the tilting train. But it needed some finishing touches. At first, Grange was asked to sort out the paintwork on the cab, but he gave the train a whole new look.
It was just a paint job, but decently paid and very agreeable, and it was a nice enough job to get. But the train wasn't very beautiful, that's sure. But I had time enough to play games, and I chose myself to have a crack at a new shape of train.
The high-speed train was about to get its most distinctive look, the futuristic nose cone at the front and back.
On the table here, I've got two models, and they are pretty much an example of where the job started and where it ended. There's a flat area here, and it was just big enough to take quite a small piece of glass, because they had a succession of accidents, more than accidents, rather willful, of small boys hanging house bricks over bridges and smashing the glass. So the new train would have to have armour-plated glass.
Without telling British Rail, Grange used sophisticated aerodynamic testing for the first time in the design of a train.
The whole point was that we virtually exchanged the smooth curvature here for a much better rake here, so we could, you know, get more air flowing over the top relative to this one. We used to hire space in the wind tunnel down at Imperial College, and gradually, with the technicians down there, we'd gradually improve the shape aerodynamically. And so when the day came to show them my new livery of their model, I took my own design along as well. And it's a pretty extraordinary tale on reflection that they were, you know, broad-minded enough and open-minded enough to take some note of what I was saying.
But if the high-speed train doesn't get off to its high-speed launch, as the timetables proudly announce, then the whole impact of the service will be lost.
Kenneth Grange's prototype was a one-man cab with a small central window. But trouble broke out with the drivers' union ASLEF. For a year, they refused to test the new train.
This proposal was put before our annual conference in June. The delegates attending that annual conference were actual train drivers, people who were driving trains day in, day out, said, not on your life.
The unions came back and had changed their mind, or some cause, but whatever it was, and were insisting upon two men, which threw us in a real dilemma, because this single glass size was very difficult to resolve. You couldn't have them two men looking out of the one little window.
To only have one driver in there, there are instances where you need an inspector on there, you need broom for training, you need a seat for somebody that's perhaps piloting or conducting, a driver who's on a particular route that he hasn't been on before. It would have been farcical to have had just a central sitting seat in HST.
So Kenneth Grange redesigned the cab with a bigger window. He also decided to remove the pair of buffers at the front.
These set of accidents all eventually worked to my favour, frankly. The loss of the buffers was a key change in the geometry of the train, and that in turn led to the style we've got now.
The train's unique trademark had been created, its front cab.
As it were, stylistic origins of the design, I think don't owe much to other vehicles. They might have owed something to racing cars, which were not nearly as ugly as they are today. They were much sleeker and in a way looked like a cartoonist drawing of a fast car. I think that was perhaps some starting point.
But because of another 1970s social phenomenon, football hooligans, part of Grange's design didn't make it into the train. He made seats for the passenger compartments using netting developed for the United States space program. But the seats weren't tough enough for match day trains.
Didn't take much wit to see that a net chair would be an absolute gift to them. You know, you'd go strip in and bing, and you'd have no seat at all. Not a seat with just holes in it, you'd have no seat at all. So it was stillborn, the net seat.
Most people thought the prototype train was a rather ugly looking brute. But the final version that Kenneth Grange produced was absolutely magnificent.
What had been created was an ultra-modern train with two power cabs, one at each end. That meant a faster ride powered by two engines. The stopgap had turned from an ugly duckling into a swan.
I think of everything I've done, that probably is number one. I'm fairly proud of it, yes. More than fairly, you can tell.
With a new look and two drivers in the cab, the high-speed train went into service.
I tell you, this is a family business. Wherever I go, I find it's a family business, isn't it?
Peter Parker saw his chance to promote a new image of the railways. He'd been handed an exciting product. Now it needed to be sold. In the late 1970s, a brash businessman was trying to conquer the world of advertising. Peter Marsh had a gift for publicity, sometimes about himself. In an industry of extrovert characters, he was one of the most colourful of the lot.
Say it again, Cyril Lord, chunky carpet, Cyril Lord, get off me, Barrett, Cyril Lord, chunky carpet, Cyril Lord, I am full.
Marsh was the frontman for a thriving agency, Alan Brady & Marsh. They used Hollywood star Orson Welles to sell sherry. They advertised everything from chewing gum to cleaning products. Now Marsh was chasing one of the biggest prizes of all, the British Rail advertising account.
We're really looking at one very specific ingredient here, and one of the most important ingredients, which is personality.
Okay, well, I better leave you. Good luck. Have a good trip.
Marsh had been an actor, and he knew Parker loved theatre. The ad man saw an opportunity. He invited Parker to his office. The British Rail chairman was about to get a surprise.
I invited Peter to lunch, and when he arrived in reception, I got this terrible old tart of reception. It was actually, see there. Yeah, what's your name? Picker, who are you seeing? Marsh? Just sit down. Really terribly different.
They were just sat in a waiting room, rather than being met by the directors or whatever, which they might have expected.
He's sitting there, obviously, not being very pleased. Yeah, you see the doorway over there, over your left shoulder? Now, don't you know your left from your right, over there? Go and sit in there, Mr. Marsh will come and see you in a minute.
And this waiting room was scruffy, dirty. There were smelly, unemptied ashtrays, dirty floor, unkempt.
It is sort of sprouting penicillin. These stale coffee cups and tea cups and plastic receptacles.
And they sat there like this for about 15, 20 minutes, wondering what was going on.
And Peter's sitting there, fuming. And I time it perfectly. I will say, hello, Peter, sorry to keep you waiting. What I've been trying to demonstrate to you in this surroundings and the indifference of our receptionists there is the experience that your customers have of you, British Rail, every day. And it's my job and intention to show you how we will overcome that problem. So go and have lunch. There was my blue Rolls Royce at the door, and off we went.
The train of platform four.
This is it, the new Intercity 125. And as you can see, a pretty futuristic looking train. So are the performance figures. As the name implies, top speed 125 miles per hour.
By now, the high-speed train had a new name, the Intercity 125. It was Europe's fastest regular rail service. And at last, British Rail was starting to get some positive coverage on TV.
Rail travel was certainly never like this when I was a train spotter. All carriages fully air-conditioned throughout and linked with automatic doors.
I can remember the 125 when it first began, going on it and being absolutely carried away by the speed and the comfort.
And I suppose in this, the brand new era of high-speed rail travel, it just had to come. The high-speed loop.
We went roaring along the track. I mean, that was the smoothest ride I'd ever seen.
Well, any train worth travelling on's really got to have a decent bar and buffet, and in British Rail terms, this is the last word. They don't come any better than this.
It looked very glamorous, but it was the people's train.
But as if that's not enough, for the very first time in British Rail history, you can now enjoy the delights of the British Rail pizza. But most important of all, comfortable seating, and absolutely nothing has been left to chance there. Believe it or not, all the seats on this train are ergonomically designed.
This is 222 Marylebone Road. It used to be British Rail's corporate headquarters. Now, it's a luxury hotel.
Thank you very much.
And this is where ad man Peter Marsh made his final pitch to Peter Parker for the biggest opportunity of his career, the British Rail advertising account.
When we pitched for the account with Peter there, we had decided a presenter was the most economic way of presenting a multitude of information that is available to you. Also, because we'd have to make a lot of commercials, we wanted the production costs to be very low.
It was make or break. Six agencies, including Marsh's biggest rivals, Saatchi & Saatchi, were in the running. Marsh had to follow up his waiting room stunt with a spectacular presentation, but he was about to play his trump card.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Top of the Pops. Oh. And good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome indeed to Jimmo Fix It.
Jimmy Savile was at the peak of his fame, and he'd already shown his interest in the new high-speed trains.
I'm really jealous of you. Was it good?
Yes.
Was it really smashing?
Yes.
Wow, that's quite tremendous. Mr. Driver, sir, what can I say? Oh. What a thrill for this young lad.
We audition for presenters. And the way you test them on the target market, you have what we call a candidate statement.
Marsh's researchers produce candidate statements from possible presenters, including Jimmy Savile and Terry Wogan, saying they believed in British Rail. Members of the public were asked for their reaction.
When we got to Jimmy Savile, the candidate statement was the same for everybody. I believe in an integrated, publicly owned rail service that gives customer value, is intent on modernisation, and will present real value to the customer. Everybody endorsed that with Jimmy Savile.
And good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Top of the Pops.
At first, Peter Parker wasn't sure about Marsh's choice of presenter. He asked for more market research.
I think he saw him as a, you know, somebody who was something of a disc jockey, popular with young people and such like, and perhaps didn't realise how popular he was.
Peter Parker then brought up the presenter, Jimmy Savile. He said, "Peter, are you quite sure about this man?" And I said, "Well, we're a bit like a doctor, Peter. We don't have to love our patients to give them the correct advice."
And now what shall we have now? Should we have the number one? I think we should have the number one.
Because of the robustness of the results, we cannot other than recommend him without any reservation.
British Rail said, "Would you like to come and talk to us about your experiences on trains and such like? Obviously, there are some that I can't tell you about, which are a pride and joy to me."
Jimmy did claim to travel, I think it's something like 20-odd thousand miles a year by train, as well as in his Rolls Royce.
"I walk from John O'Groats to Land's End, and I got news for you. After anything like that, a train of any sort, shape or size, and any speed, is a thing of joy and pleasure to me."
The decision was made. Marsh's agency was hired. The railways were going to be rebranded, and Peter Marsh was celebrating what was said to be the biggest account move in British advertising history.
"Businessmen and business ladies, you don't need me to tell you that the long drive before a long meeting is a bit of a strain. So why not do what I do? Take the train."
Soon, the first advertisements were broadcast. It was a simple formula. A celebrity presenter and lots of shots of the brand new 125.
"I travel about 39,000 rail miles a year on business. Much more comfortable and less worrying than driving. I get to meetings relaxed and on time because this is the age of the train."
It was tremendously successful, tremendously successful. Well, I think it was a combination of using Jimmy Savile, who was clearly extremely popular right across the class structure in the country, and a structure as well.
"Don't you deserve half fares too?"
"Yeah!"
It used modern images of the railway. The high-speed train would feature somewhere in most of the adverts, even if it was just rushing by at the end.
I didn't like him very much, but I don't have to. I found him, when he delivered his work, he was brilliant.
"There's no place like London for doing your Christmas shopping. London's full of excitement."
I will put up with anything. Because when you're a professional, you have to deal with people that you wouldn't choose to go to the opera with.
"Travel off-peak weekdays or any time most weekends and you pay much less than the ordinary fare. East Croydon to London."
The ads might have been simple, but they were carefully put together.
"You'd be amazed how many people are doing their Christmas shopping in London this year. Why not join us?
Because this is the
of the train."
We researched it, and the emotional impact was enormous, and it stuck in people's minds like a burr under the saddle.
"This is the age of the train."
Very good, thank you.
"This is the age of the train." Something like that. About all that. It never seemed to go any further than that. It just was, "This is the age of the train."
This, dear me, I'll have to cut that.
And it used to be spoken as well sometimes by Jimmy Savile, you know, "This is the age of the train." And the train would rush by.
"This is the age of the train."
Speaking as a faithful, hard-working, considerate husband, all I can say...
Quickly, the slogan was part of everyday life.
"But that means I'll have to go to Ipswich by train."
"But it'd be quicker. After all, this is the age of the train."
"I'm not concerned about the age of the train. I don't care how old it is. The only question is, will it be running?"
They were deliberately kept simple, because that's all you need. And people respond to messages. They don't respond to padding. He's got a smart suit on, and he's got this enthusiasm as he addresses the camera, because he certainly believes in what he's saying.
"With this rail card, senior citizens get half-price travel."
We were very conscious that when he's on top of the pops, he deliberately cultivates a very zany image, not only in the clothes that he wears, and also that, he used to do, but also in his hair, which sometimes looks awful. But we very, very meticulously briefed him on the wardrobe and approved the wardrobe, and also on the hairstyle. Because you saw the slight problem when we were on the motorway gantry, you get the hair blown about. If it's very long, it is a bit distracting.
"So why not do what I do? Take the train."
For once, nearly everyone agreed British Rail had got it right. In the early 1980s, the age of the train was one of the best-known ad campaigns in Britain. but some people on the railways weren't convinced.
Don't ask me to sing that. The thing is that I remember it. This is the age of the train. Well, it was that, the adverts were good enough, but I don't think they delivered much for the railway.
At the peak of the advertising campaign's success, Peter Parker used Jimmy Savile to help launch a new rail card for wheelchair users. Despite the initial doubts, the two men had established a good working relationship, even when things didn't go to plan.
Today, this train couldn't take the strain.
Right, I think we're in.
What do you do when a larger-than-usual wheelchair won't go through the standard sliding door? Just take out another seat and try again.
We'll learn from this. Things will go wrong a bit. We'll learn from that. And so I see us, as I say, building from this bridgehead.
In the end, Peter Parker was so pleased with what Jimmy Savile had done that he gave him a gold pass, which meant he could travel anywhere first class all over the system.
Let the train take you on your business trips because of the train.
Well, I think the fact that we remember the advertisements, those who were around at the time remember them clearly, suggests that they were very powerful.
Now, how about this then? London to Ketchum, 58 minutes. London to Derby, 1 hour, 57 minutes. London to Sheffield, 2 hours, 29 minutes. That's how late some of the trains are from this country.
And, you know, we had that slogan at the time, this is the age of the train. And we used to get all the time ribbed, yeah, it's 40 years old or it's 50 years old, the age of the train being, you know, this decrepit thing.
But don't take my word for it. Let my good friend here tell you for himself.
The Intercity 125 was a big hit with passengers, but they still weren't sure about one thing, the food.
Well, I wouldn't have caught this train except I had the presence of mind to eat a British Rail pie, and I soon caught up with it.
Can you get onto them and say that those must go in, even if it's at the expense of 3, 4, and 5, which isn't...
Prue Leith, who'd made her name in the restaurant business, was recruited by Peter Parker onto the British Rail board. He asked her to tackle a long-standing problem, the much-maligned onboard catering.
Dear sir, all the way up to Glasgow, all they had in the buffet was a plastic knife and one individual beetroot pie. I couldn't even cut it. Yours, Arthur Fingers. Now, that's ridiculous. Nonsense. Nonsense. Look, I mean, here is the knife, and here is the pie. I mean, look at that.
Everybody talks about curly sandwiches. And he said to me, when he hired me, he said, you know, if nothing else, you get the curl out of the sandwiches. In fact, it was never curly sandwiches the problem. It was soggy sandwiches. I remember arguing with the caterers at the time and saying, why can't we have more interesting sandwiches? And they say, well, this is Britain's most popular sandwich. And I'd say, but of course it is, it's the only sandwich. And they said, no, it's the most popular sandwich because it has Britain's most popular bread, which is Mother's Pride, Britain's most popular cheese, which is Kraft cheese slice, and Britain's most popular butter, Anchor butter.
Some passengers liked the food.
When people were moaning about British Rail sandwiches, well, I can remember when they would actually make the sandwiches fresh. And a fresh bread and a fresh cheese and tomato sandwich, you know, the cheese wasn't, Borsal cheese wasn't the best, but it was adequate cheese and a fresh tomato. It was all right.
I thought the food on British Rail was actually better than it is now, actually. I think the lovely thing about travelling on a train, frankly, even a train that went much slower than the 125, was that you'd be able to go to the dining car, sit down, have a very, very good meal indeed, with wonderful waiters who enjoyed it, and it was all very pally and nice and luxurious.
On the railways, catering was like industrial relations. Trying to keep everyone happy was a problem without easy answers.
I never thought we got British Rail food right on the trains. I think we did much better on the stations. From then on, I was always credited with uncurling the British Rail sandwich, but I didn't really do that. But we did get decent boxes for them.
And I would just like to remember some words of St. Francis of Assisi, which I think are really just particularly apt at the moment. Where there is discord, may we bring harmony. Where there is error...
At Westminster, the times were changing. Peter Marsh was asked for an ad man's assessment of the new Prime Minister. He gave a cautious verdict.
We know there's a degree of male chauvinism in this country, a bit of misogynism or whatever that is. And so I think one would have to look very carefully and say, how do you present her as a person so that she does not put off too many men?
So when Margaret Thatcher came on the scene, I was delighted. But she had a deep loathing of British Rail.
You can knock on the door.
Hello, welcome. Come in.
I think that successive chairmen of British Rail would have had trouble with that administration.
Come on, Jimmy. Nice to see you. Wonderful. Right.
They were very anti-railway. I don't think that... that if Peter Parker had made the earth flat, it wouldn't have been a success as far as the Thatcher administration is concerned.
And I think it was a bit to do with Dennis, who was a wonderful man, that nationalisation to them was death of private enterprise, industry and drive.
To her critics, the new Prime Minister seemed more comfortable in a tank than a train. For Peter Parker, she was a problem. He'd been appointed by Labour. Worse still, Mrs. Thatcher appeared to dislike travelling on the railways.
According to reports, the Prime Minister has a particular dislike of British Rail. It's known she goes by car. She goes by air. She also, perhaps appropriately, is not averse to the odd trip by Chefton Tank. But never, ever were told does she travel by train. I suspect she has another form of public transport as she flits across the sky at night on her personal broomstick.
Okay, well done.
Public transport wasn't high on the government's agenda.
Well, I think we'll launch the champagne, but I...
The Transport Minister, Norman Fowler, was the man in the middle between British Rail and Mrs. Thatcher.
I think she was a sceptic as far as the railways were concerned. It was not top of her list of pops.
Mrs. Thatcher probably thought trains were bad news. I mean, I'm not quite sure why I say that, but I mean, she just sort of thought lots of things are bad news.
We had one dramatically awful lunch in opposition. When I was shadow transport minister, we went to lunch with Peter and his board. And someone made the great mistake of saying to Margaret Thatcher over lunch, you know, there's only one thing wrong with British Rail, Mrs. Thatcher, and that is we don't have enough money. And this absolutely sent her vertical. And she lectured them solidly about public spending, I think, for the next 30 minutes.
Peter Parker and Mrs. Thatcher would never be soulmates, but he needed to make sure they could work together.
Peter was one of these people who do live on the pinko, lefto, sido of the partio. He was the sort of man that you could disagree with his politics. You could not disagree with his application of his philosophy of life.
Parker persuaded Mrs. Thatcher to help name a train in memory of her friend and colleague, Airey Neave. But that didn't necessarily mean she was a fan of the railways.
To name a locomotive after Airey Neave is a wonderful idea.
She wasn't a great supporter, a great lover of the railways, but as in all these things, she was fairly pragmatic when it came to policy making. So she came from a very sceptic side of the argument about railways, but it didn't, nevertheless, didn't have this dramatic effect upon policy.
Most of Britain might be falling in love with the 125s, but the Prime Minister told British Rail she disliked the open-plan carriages.
Generally speaking, this was very popular with the public. It was particularly with women, because they felt safer in an open environment than in closed compartments. But Mrs. Thatcher thought the loss of privacy was important, which is one of the reasons why she didn't travel by train.
Well, that's an interesting point. I mean,
under the Thatcher regime, Peter Parker was riding on the success of the 125. What's more, its long-delayed rival, the APT tilting train, was finally about to enter service. But he had colleagues who thought high-speed trains were costing too much money.
Well, the point is, it seems to be that investment is in fancy things like APTs and high-speed trains, yeah, and all the gloss and is not initiated by the sheer inevitability of rotting assets.
And ageing fleets.
In all the nationalised industries, there were fears of possible privatisation. Parker still couldn't be sure about the future of the railways. It was the early 80s, a boom time, at least for some. There was a new kind of commuter, people who could afford to travel more than 100 miles to work, and that was good news for the Intercity 125.
There's no question that the 125 also produced an out-of-town commuter.
Yes, if you can get from A to B that much faster, it reduces the commuting time. And people might like to live in the fairly remote rural area, and the price of a season ticket is worth it, provided the trains are fast.
People in Peterborough, Grantham, Bristol, and in Birmingham, they came into London, they commuted. It was easy to do, and it still is.
30 years ago, the BBC filmed advertising executive Barry Smith, who commuted every day from Bristol to London. On the new 125s, the journey took around an hour and a half.
Now then, gentlemen, what can I get for you this morning?
The usual, please, Brian.
Poached eggs, well-done bacon.
Crispy bacon.
Crispy bacon, very good, sir.
Same for me, Brian, please.
Very good, sir, thank you.
Yeah, same for me.
Now Barry's back, with two friends who used to travel with him.
It was a serious bonus, I mean, because that cut the journey time, I think, in those days, by half an hour, which is a considerable time.
That's right. The prospect of a breakfast is always pleasing.
We've got some mushrooms and potatoes and tomatoes coming around for you now.
The British Rail breakfast was absolutely wonderful. The staff were wonderful serving it, and we got to know them all, and we could have kippers, which was my favourite breakfast most of the time, or bacon and egg, and it was well cooked, and it was absolutely excellent.
Travel the stunning Intercity 125.
In Mrs. Thatcher's Britain, there was money to be made. Some passengers were living the dream.
A world you can work in. Even at speeds like this, you're not tied to your seat.
For Barry and his friends, business was good. They travelled first class at a cost of more than £5,000 a year.
If you're going to embark on doing this kind of journey, or ridiculous journey, as some people used to say, then you might as well make the most of it.
On Intercity 125, you're in a world where you're looked after in real comfort while someone else drives. So you arrive fresh, feeling businesslike, all of which proves that for anyone going places in today's business world, this is the age of the train.
The earliest I can make it is probably about 7 o'clock tonight. So I don't get back from London until I catch an early train, 6:30.
I think at the time, the phone from memory was the brick, unlike the modern day BlackBerry. And so you wouldn't spend a great deal of time on the phone with the old phone, because it wouldn't last that long. To me, being able to live in the West Country and enjoy the slow lifestyle of Bristol and surrounding area, and then to go up to London every day, was the ideal opportunity.
In the 1980s, about 80 Bristol to London commuters went on the train every day.
I think you've got little bunches of people that all gathered together like we did. And there wasn't just the three of us, there were other people that came and went and joined our party. It was a party on the way home, quite a lot.
Fridays, we'd probably bring a bottle of champagne along and have Buck's Fizz. And it is Friday today, by the way, and I see no Buck's Fizz.
For the first time since the 1940s, a feeling of confidence was back on the railways. To celebrate the 125, British Rail even commissioned an overture. A special film was made and released as a support feature in cinemas. The Intercity 125 had made it onto the big screen.
I think the great thing about the 125 is that it was just right for this country. We have distances of up to 200 miles, really, basically, except for Glasgow and Edinburgh, which are sort of 300 or 400 miles. But for most cities of this country, 125 miles an hour ain't bad. And that works super, still does work very, very well.
Peter Snow's got a model railway track in his attic. He says it's for his family. And he's got a special new train for his collection.
Well, I'm very excited because we've managed to find on the internet a 125 set. Intercity 125. They're actually quite rare to get hold of. We have here, let's try it, a 125. Let's hope it works. Intercity 125 from 1976, a triumph of British Rail. Will it run? Yes, it's running. Hooray! There she is. Looking as lovely as she looked all those 30-odd years ago. Look at that. It was a way of getting very quickly from London to the north. And, oh, hello, what's happened here? We have a crisis. Oh, I see what's happened. It's for some reason come right off the line. Hang on. A derailment has occurred. Fortunately, it's only a model railway, so it doesn't really matter too much. The 125. I was in one the other day, that guy took me into the guards van, and I sat there watching, and we was just the needle was on 120, 125, 127 occasionally. I gather it cuts off much above 127. Then we were flashing along. About 10 years ago, I put it all together. This is the loft of our house. It's all rather lovely, and it keeps me going. I mean, all the grandchildren love it, and even some of the children, the sort of 30-year-olds, quite enjoy coming up here. To be honest, I did it mainly for myself. I mustn't pretend that I was doing it entirely for grandchildren. That'd be quite wrong.
In the early 80s, British Rail had never been so popular. One set of engineers had been watching the 125's success with interest, the team working on the rival advanced passenger train project. They'd had a frustrating wait because of technical problems, but now they were ready to go.
The central station in Glasgow this morning before 7.
At long last, the space-age APT tilting train was going into service, after 13 years' work and a cost of £37 million. Now the Intercity 125 had a challenger, and the newcomer could run at 155 miles an hour.
The coffee stays level, but the coaches tilt inwards on the curves by as much as 9 degrees. This allows the APT to take bends up to 40% faster than conventional trains.
The tilt, no discomfort at all. In fact, if anything, it improves the ride.
I've been very impressed. I think it's been a very good ride. I think it's very comfortable. And altogether, I think this is one of Britain's great technological achievements.
It was too revolutionary for its own good. The lightweight construction was right. But then it started to get a bit too clever.
The tilting train's third run from Glasgow was a very public outing, a trip packed with journalists and cameramen.
Do you think you're going to make it to London today?
Oh, of course we are.
The guards seemed to be confident anyway, and we slid out of Glasgow on time at 7 o'clock. But after only 8 minutes, the lights flickered and dimmed, and APT coasted to a shameful halt.
If it weren't so serious, it would be funny. I mean, they took a whole party of journalists and train spotters up to Glasgow and put us on this new train. And of course, they got absolutely terrible press.
The train got through the borders, the scene of her last breakdown, but there was more trouble at Preston. The changeover guard didn't seem to be at all familiar with the expensive new technology.
Not a joke, how does this work?
Extraordinarily difficult. And whenever there was a problem with it, I mean, everybody just, media-wise, leapt on the bandwagon.
A crew, the quintessential railway town, APT decided enough was enough.
It's now 11:15, the time we were due to arrive at Euston. But here we are at Crewe, 158 miles from London. And we've been told that because of adverse weather conditions down the line, the advanced passenger train will be terminating its journey right here.
Its real problem, I think, was that the tilt was too good.
I remember feeling that I was having my breakfast in the gutter, that the train seemed to tilt an extraordinary degree. It was like being in an aeroplane coming in to land on a very tight incline. And certainly a lot of people felt queasy. I didn't, as it happens. I travel okay. But a lot of people did feel queasy. And it was an unusual sight to see journalists turning down a free meal.
One particular journalist was very poorly coming back. But it didn't have a lot to do with the train. It had a lot to do with the fact he stayed in the bars of the Singing Ox Hotel till about 4 o'clock in the morning.
The canard was that on the press trip from London to Glasgow, all the press had been boozed up the night before, and that's what made them sick. Well, I hadn't. And I felt fine until it got daylight, and then started to feel queasy, and a lot of us did.
For the once glamorous tilting train, it was a fatal blow. The train was taken out of service and became an attraction at a heritage centre in Crewe. For the foreseeable future, the Intercity 125 was the only high-speed train in town.
The PR policy is you can't possibly ever drop your guard. You have to be always watching. We were perhaps too anxious to get this feather in our cap. In business, it's always clever if you can be second. That's the first thing. It's always better to be in the second wave than hitting the beach.
Almost immediately, Peter Parker was at the centre of another crisis. In 1982, the railways were shut down during a strike about flexible work rotas. This battle had been coming for a long time. Mrs. Thatcher was watching, and Parker was determined to win, despite the cost.
The Wednesday board will be reviewing the following week, but the damage is formidable now on the commercial and financial side.
We knew that in order to make progress with these long-term plans for the railway, it needed substantial improvements in productivity. And that became a big hurdle.
I've already sent a letter to your office by hand.
Sir Peter, for God's sake, Ray, can you look me
That's
in the...
That's the truth. With all honesty, you wasn't there. It was your man,
down,
Cliff Rose,
that brought...
The trade unions were very powerful. Remember, they'd had 6 or 7 years of a Labour government during the 70s, and they had acquired an awful lot of power through the beer and sandwiches route at number 10.
We've never, by the way, had 7 to 9 rosters put before us until the 22nd of January. That's when we first got into the
union. Why do you think that was?
The strike was about so-called flexible rostering, the number of hours a train driver could work during a shift.
What British Rail wanted to do was to have more flexibility in the length of time a driver would work within the maximum amount. And obviously the unions wanted more money for that. Well, they were against it.
To be blathering on in this detail when all of this could be tidied up by an independent tribunal.
It was the worst possible situation you'd get to, because it ended up both sides arguing with each other and almost, you know, slagging each other off in a television studio live. And the last thing you should ever do is get involved in negotiating industrial problems live on a national television programme.
But Parker got his victory. After 2 weeks, the strike was abandoned. Mrs. Thatcher's government was impressed.
The privatisation of the whole of British Rail, which simply wasn't on the agenda at the moment, what we wanted to do was to try and run the railways as efficiently and as effectively as we possibly could.
Far away across Europe, another train and another girl. Or rather, a boy and a girl.
With the strike behind him, Peter Parker could return to his dreams of a new high-speed rail link to Europe. He had the backing of Norman Fowler, and indeed, support for a Channel Tunnel had already come from an unexpected source.
Well, I wasn't that confident when I went to see Margaret at number 10 about this project. I'd be perfectly frank, I didn't think that I would have her on my side. But I then explained to her that what I was proposing was not that the Treasury should put in billions of pounds into it, but what I was proposing was it should be privately financed. And basically her reply to that was, if it's privately financed, I don't see there's any thing against it.
I should be very happy if we could...
There had been a stroke of luck, a summit meeting between Mrs. Thatcher, a Eurosceptic, and the new French president, François Mitterrand, a lifelong socialist.
Nous regardons où nous mettons les pieds.
They found it hard to agree on anything.
I would like to say that we've had excellent talks, both between the President and myself.
The one thing we could agree upon, because every one of these meetings needs a communique at the end, the one thing we could agree upon was the Channel Tunnel. And actually, Margaret was rather grateful for the Channel Tunnel at that point.
It's a project that bears the Prime Minister's personal imprint. A massive, privately funded venture, high-tech, yet driven by an entrepreneurial vision that might have impressed Brunel.
It's very unfashionable to say, but the Thatcher years were really good for the railways.
At the French end of the new intercapital rail link, President Mitterrand unveiled a plaque in Paris's Gare du Nord and set out aboard the new high-speed Eurostar passenger train.
Under Margaret Thatcher, we saw the railways advance more, British Rail advance more than it had done in the previous two decades.
Margaret Thatcher is an astonishing woman because she started the Channel Tunnel. It wasn't a government operation, it was all privately run, privately financed, but she was the one who got it going. Good luck to her for doing that.
Trains aren't thought to be all that popular with the Prime Minister.
Perhaps surprisingly, Mrs. Thatcher helped establish a new era of high-speed trains. British Rail was only privatised after she left Downing Street when John Major was Prime Minister.
Here we are caught so much in the short term and the chaos and the ragged railway.
Peter Parker left British Rail in 1983 after seeing off calls for drastic cuts. British Rail was back on track. He died in 2002. But his legacy lives on. This is still the age of the high-speed train. A new, fast service is planned between London and Birmingham. 40 years on, the 125 isn't just history. It's still a mainstay of the railways, and it will be for many years to come.
I like to know that it's coming from way down the track, the lights, and then the thing gradually turns into a form and so on. And then I look to see how clean it is, you know, because that's mine, and they can't escape the fact that I own it.
We owe it to the 125 for rescuing British Rail from near destruction, really, near collapse in the early 70s and mid-70s. And I think if it hadn't been for the 125, we'd be in terrible trouble.
I think it's a train whose time is still coming. It was originally a stopgap with perhaps say a 30-year life, but it's been re-engineered with new engines, the coaches have been modernised.
The scale of the improvement in rail passengers over the last 10, 15 years has been extraordinary. And I think a lot of that is due to the 125, catching the public imagination.
More than 80 of the trains are still in service. Rail engineers now say the Intercity 125 is capable of running until 2035.
If I'd been asked to guess how long it would last, I would never have guessed as long as it has. And so I'm thrilled to bits that it's still out there holding its own, and it'll see a few more liveries and a few more owners, I expect. I only regret not having one. I've got most of everything else I did, but I don't have a train. Getting hold of a train's a bit tricky.